Good morning, everybody. Welcome back to the channel. Second video of the weekend. I don't do this very often. I posted a Saturday review yesterday, which was basically a summing up of everything that I've been watching and looking at over the last probably four or five, six weeks, something like that. There'll be another of those probably in about a month, something like that. But it seems to have gone down very well. So, and I also posted this morning another reaction video, basically watching Rambo from 2008. So that should be on the group now. So if you want to see me watching Rambo and making a complete nonna of myself yet again, that's on there now. So I'll start with a few comments on last week's video. Thanks to everybody that's commented, by the way. I love reading these things, I really do. Callie, another awesome episode, hon. Thanks for the shout. You're more than welcome. Scott, excellent video, Tony. Loved it, mate. Thank you for having me in the group. You're more than welcome, Scott. You truly are more than welcome. You've fitted in absolutely beautifully with everybody. It's like you've been here forever. So, yeah. Honestly, mate, it's good to have you aboard. The Forgotten Movies section on there is fantastic. It's cracking, isn't it? We've got Jason to thank for that one. And I believe he's got another thread up and ready to go next year, which is going to last a whole year. But he won't give us any clues as to what it is. And I have no idea. So I'm really looking forward to finding out what that is. But that's sort of, what, 8 months away? So we've got a while to wait for that one. But we've certainly got enough to keep us going with the Forgotten Movies. And you're right, it is a cracking thread. You also mentioned Pump Up the Volume is brilliant. You'll love it. I do intend taking a look at this. I believe it's out on Blu-ray on April the 3rd. So there's a very good chance I'll be invested in a copy of that. To take a look at. It's a movie I do remember vaguely. I've never seen it, but I do remember the trailer slightly. So it's one that I'm going to go into pretty much blind. Does he play some kind of a DJ? That's the impression I'm getting from the sleeve. But we'll see how we go with that one. So thanks for the comments, Scott. Much appreciated. Dave Lowe, great video, Tony. Cheers, Dave. We were enjoying Cocaine Bear, but I had to turn it off because the missus didn't like the ambulance scene. I need to finish it later. My God, that was the best part of it. I'd never seen anything quite like that. Spectacular. Absolutely brilliant. And the movie itself, just superb. A complete throwback to the Animal Attack movies of the 70s and 80s. Which I absolutely can't get enough of. I did the top 10, well, my top 10 Animal Attack movies on the Saturday review yesterday, which seems to have gone down quite well. And the nearest one I could find to Cocaine Bear was Grizzly, which I was showing off, which is a cracking movie from 1976. And if you like Cocaine Bear and you want something a little more serious, Grizzly is the one to go for. So, let's see. Oh, the mystery movie, by the way. You've solved it, Dave, or at least I think you have. As for the mystery movie, the first thing that came to my mind from the description was a movie called Mercy Mission, The Rescue of Flight 771. Watched it ages ago, and it's a proper tearjerker. So, Jeff, if you're watching, this is our model railway guy. Is it the one? This is what it, well, Dave thinks he's got it. So if you look that one up on the IMDb, I think you'll find that the description is pretty much exactly as you described it. So hopefully we've solved that one for you. So thanks for that, Dave. Rick, Cocaine Bear was pure entertainment. Absolutely it was. I will be investing in a 4K copy of that when it comes out. I don't know whether I'll be paying sort of 25 quid for it, but after a few months they usually come down to about 20 or 15. So I will be getting a copy of that because I bet it will look absolutely stunning on 4K. You mentioned about the BBFC because I mentioned being surprised that it passed for a 15. Not so much for the violence, but for the scene where the kids try cocaine. It's all played for laughs, obviously, and that's what you said. I think the BBFC passed it as a 15 due to it being comedy and not serious. So yeah, I would tend to agree with that, mate. Awesome video as always, Tony. Thanks to Rick. Can't wait for your Rambo 4 reaction. Your prayers have been answered. It's on there now. Stay safe, mate. Don't Oh, here we go. Don't want you putting your channel down. It's great, buddy. Defo one of a kind. That's basically on the back of something that I said. And I can't remember what it was. I've made extensive notes here, but I've forgotten to put that down. But basically, you replied that you'd actually been following the channel, which is quite correct. You'd been following the channel way before you joined the Facebook group. And I'd completely forgotten about that. I really appreciate you saying that about it being one of a kind. I think that's partly the key to it, is making it slightly different. I know it's not, you know, professional looking and this, that and the other. It is just me sitting here with a mug of tea, chatting bollocks about films for half an hour. But like you, I've not seen anybody that does anything quite like this. So I really appreciate you pointing that out. And I will keep doing what I'm doing, definitely. I can't see the point in changing what I class as a winning format. You guys seem to like it, and I do this mainly for you guys, so there's absolutely no point in changing anything. But I will be talking a bit later about some additional things that are coming in. What else have I got here? Oh, the Saturday review comments. This is the video that I posted yesterday. Jason Kerr, at Ginger Ninja. Awesome Saturday review, Tony. Thanks for that, mate. I was talking about which franchise I was going to go with after I finish the Rocky movies. And you said, got to go with Planet of the Apes, absolute classics. I mean, I've got that here somewhere. Bear with me. So that's the box set that I've got. I did watch the original yesterday for about the 150th time. Absolutely loved it for the 150th time. So many quotable lines in there. But I'm definitely looking forward to getting into the sequels on this one. I've seen them all before, but a long, long time ago. I remember seeing Escape to the Planet of the Apes on a double bill with this original. God, that would have been about 1974, 5, something like that, at the local Odeon. And I fell in love with them, absolutely fell in love with these films. So I think this is the next franchise that I'm going to move on to. I know, Jason, you want me to do Mission Impossible, and I will come on to that, I promise. But I'm really enthusiastic for these movies, because I do love them. But Mission Impossible will happen, I promise you. What else have you put here? Oh, great top 10 list, mate. Grizzly is a lot of fun. I loved it, absolutely loved it. A lot more serious than Cocaine Bear, but absolutely brilliant. The Meg is pretty good. It's not great, but it's a giant shark, so I was sold on it. I was pretty much the same. I don't understand all the negative reviews of The Meg. It's just a good, fun action movie with Jason Statham at his best fighting a 900-foot shark. I thought it was great. Day of the Animals is an absolute classic. Leslie Nielsen was such a different role. He was horrible in that, wasn't he? We all know him from the Naked Gun films, but in that he played an absolute horror of a man. But again, that was on a double bill with a movie called The Car back in 1977 or 78. First double A feature that I went to see. Double A was only over 14s. So yeah, I've got very fond memories of that. Oh, you mentioned The Car as well. The Car, solid film. Skip the sequel. Too late. I haven't watched it, but I managed to get hold of a copy. I do want to see it, but I know for a fact it's not going to live up to the memories I've got of the original. It just won't. It couldn't possibly. I've already read the basic plot line of it, and it's not what I'm particularly looking forward to, but I feel I should have a look at it. When I mentioned it yesterday, Gareth said that there was a sequel. I didn't even realise this film existed. It's called The Car, Road to Revenge. It was made in 2019. Completely slips under my radar. I'd never even heard of it. So thanks for that, Gareth. Much appreciate you putting me onto that. And I will be taking a look at that. That will be part of Sequelophobia, which, as you'll find out later, is coming back. What else have I got here? Squirm, I watched a few years back, working an overnight shift at work. Not bad. Yeah, it wasn't the best of the Animal Attack movies by any means, but I do remember it being controversial back in the day, 1976 when it first came out. It was one of those few movies, as I remember, that got a London release but not a proper UK release. mostly for the violence in it. But I mean, it may look pretty tame now. I know it's not one of Jason's favorite. You're not a great fan of worms, I know. But I would definitely watch it again, and I will be doing. The Swarm, I have heard of but never seen. Jason, you need to get hold of The Swarm. I don't know anybody on this group that would disagree that it's an absolutely wonderful film. Irwin Allen, obviously, who did classics like The Poseidon Adventure, The Tower and Inferno, the not so legendary When Time Ran Out with Paul Newman. But The Swarm was made about 1978. I thought it was amazing. I could not at the time, and I still don't understand all the negative, horrible reviews it got. They say it's badly made, it's badly acted. Maybe I'm missing something, but I don't think it was badly made, and I certainly don't think it's badly acted. And you've got some major stars in there: Michael Caine, Henry Fonda, Richard Widmark. What's the guy who played Dr. Kildare? Richard Chamberlain, Catherine Ross. It's quite a roster of stars. Jason, promise me you will track The Swarm down, have a look at it, and do one of your little reviews, because I would love to know what you think of it. I know you will find it pretty much as good fun as I did, and still do, and pretty much everybody in the group, as I remember, seems to love that one. So yeah, promise me you'll track that one down and take a look. What else have you put here? Oh, Piranha. Haven't seen in years, but picked it up on DVD cheap. I do enjoy the remake though. Can't imagine why. Piranha was amazing, the original. Bradford Dillman and Heather Menzies, who was the female lead in the TV series of Logan's Run. I thought it was amazing. Directed by Joe Dante, who did Gremlins and various other movies. The remakes, I've not seen them. I've got them on Blu-ray. I get the feeling I've probably seen the first one. Was it 3D or something like that? I get the feeling I saw that one a long time ago, but I bought them both on Blu-ray to take a look at. So I will be doing reviews of those when I've actually had a look at that. I'm sure they won't hold a candle to the 1978 original, but we'll see how we go with them. What else have we got here? This was a good reply, mate. I really appreciate this. Alligator is amazing. Brilliant. Absolutely superb. Classic 80s animal horror, and the effects still hold up. I think they do because they're practical effects. They're not CGI. CGI never does look quite right to me, especially when you're dealing with living things. And Kingdom of the Spiders, such a good movie and a lot of creepy fun. My all-time favourite Animal Attack movie, as you know, William Shatner at his absolute best. Superb, fighting against millions of proper, real tarantulas in the days before CGI, when they literally were covered in the things. No amount of money in this world could persuade me to do that. And that's pretty much why I'm looking forward to the remake of or reboot of Arachnophobia, because the director, I think it's David Landon, has said that he is using real spiders. He's going to keep the CGI down to an absolute minimum, so it will look good. Hopefully that'll be going into production anytime now. So thanks for that, Jason. That was a cracking reply. Gareth, I enjoy the Meg more to more, I enjoy the Meg more each time I watch it. I've only seen it the once, loved it, and I do intend taking it in again, especially seeing as I included it in my top 10 Animal Attack movies. So I will be watching it again. That's when you went on to say that The Car had a recent sequel, The Car, The Road to Revenge. Have you actually seen that, Gareth? I'm just curious to know what you thought of it, if you have. It's a difficult movie to get hold of, but I've managed to get hold of a copy, so I will be taking a look. But I'd be curious to know whether you've seen it, and what you thought of it. Right, just edge these notes up a little bit. Right, taking the channel in not a slightly different direction. I'm going to try and spice things up a bit, shake them up a bit, just a little bit. There's a few bits. Let's see. I've nicked your idea, Scott. The first thing I'm going to do is a Q&A, but not a whole video of questions and answers. I'm going to answer one or maybe two questions a week. I asked this morning whether somebody could throw a question at me just to get things started, and I've had 5 or 6 replies, so I'm going to need loads for this. So guys, if you don't mind, either reply to that post with questions. I will save them all, and I will attack them sort of one or two a week. You can either personal message them to me or leave them under that post. However you do it, I just need loads and loads of questions. It doesn't have to be purely movie related. It can be music, TV, personal questions, whatever. Just send me loads of questions that I can kick this thing off. So thanks for that, Scott. You've inspired me with that one. Sequelophobia is coming back from today. I kind of dropped a couple of bits over the space of the last probably 2, 3 months. And as I said before, if you've got a winning formula, why do that? I don't know why I did that. Sequelophobia just sort of disappeared off the map. But it's coming back because it was a good little thread that I had going. I think I dropped it because I wasn't watching many sequels, which is no surprise to anybody on the group. Yeah, sequelophobia is coming back from today. Quote Encounters is coming back, but in a slightly different form, in an audio format. I haven't got one set up for today, but from next week, hopefully, I'll play you a few lines of dialogue from a movie, and you can tell me who or what the movie is. I think that'll work really well, hopefully, anyway, we'll see. Another new section that I'm going to introduce, and I might start this today actually because I've got one queued up to go. What am I watching? I will play you a little bit of soundtrack music from the original soundtrack of a movie, and you tell me what the movie is. You can put your answers in the comments below, and I will answer that one next week. Also, I thought it might be interesting to read out the box office top 10. I was going to do it weekly, but I think I might save that one for the Saturday review because I think it fits in better with that. But I'll read out the box office top 10 in a bit for this week. But I thought that might be interesting for you. Is there anything you'd like to see as a weekly thing, a new section, anything? I'm completely open to suggestions on this. I just want to make it more interesting for you guys because I know you think it's okay as it is, and I know I doubt my videos and this, that, and the other, and I don't mean to, but that's just how I am. Jason has threatened me yet again. What's he put? Oh yeah, he's going to replace my head with somebody else's every time I say something doubting about a video. So God knows what he's got in mind for that. I've ended up as the little fella from the Austin Powers movies. I think that was yesterday. God knows what else he's got in mind. So, we shall see. You mentioned, by the way. Oh yeah. I mean, as I say, suggestions, please. If there's anything that you want to see me do, pretty much weekly, just let me know. Because honestly, I'm completely open to all of this. Let's see now. You also mentioned Jason, Swiss Family Robinson. I think I saw that movie. It's a Disney film, a long time ago. John Mills was in it. Cracking movie. I think it's going to be one of your Sunday afternoon matinees over the coming weeks. I was very curious to know whether you'd heard of or seen this. Just bear with me. I remember this so well. This is from the 1970s. This is the 70s TV series of Swiss Family Robinson. Now, I don't think there is anybody what you would class as famous in this. No, there isn't. But this was great. This was staple viewing in the 1970s. I believe it was ITV that used to screen this. So I'm very curious to know whether you've seen this, and if you haven't, grab hold of a copy because it's a cracking series, mate. I think this is a 3-disc set, and it's got the entire series, 26 episodes. I got this from Amazon ages and ages ago, so whether it's still available or not, I don't know. But I would highly recommend this if you've not seen it. Just a cracking 1970s children's drama. What else have I got it? Right, I'll promise to do Bridget Swift's top 10 movies. Me and Bridget were at school together in the same year. I haven't seen her since, but we've kept in touch via Facebook. So I completely forgot to do her top 10 when I was doing that. I think it was last year I stopped doing it, and I came across her top 10 completely by accident and thought, oh my God, I've not done that. So here we go. This is Bridget's top 10, along with some honourable mentions. In no particular order, Rebecca, classic movie. Laurence Olivier, Joan Fontaine, directed by Alfred Hitchcock. Most memorable part of it for me was that creepy old nanny bird. Was it Mrs. Danvers? Called a Danny. But a marvelous film, absolutely marvelous. The Birdcage, Robin Williams, Nathan Lane, and Gene Hackman, I believe. Cracking comedy, 90s, I believe that one. The Exorcist. What can you say about The Exorcist that hasn't already been said? They are remaking it. I believe it's being released in September or October this year. Ellen Burstyn has made. Start that again. Ellen Burstyn has done the role of the mother again. She must be going on now, Ellen Burstyn. I mean, this was 1973, so you're talking 50 years ago, and I'm pretty sure she was in her 30s then, so she must be into her 80s now. But she's in the remake, which I believe is going to be a trilogy. I dread to think what it's going to look like. How can it possibly have the impact that the original had 50 years ago? I don't think it possibly can, but we'll see how we go. We'll reserve judgment until we've at least seen it. Next one, The Happy Breed. Now, this is an old film from about 1944. It's John Mills, Celia Johnson. Let's see, directed by David Lean, who obviously did like Bridge on the River Kwai, Lawrence of Arabia, big scale sort of movies like that. And it's to do with an ordinary family that's basically torn apart when World War II breaks out. I've never seen it. It's one I've always wanted to see, so I'll put that on my watch list, Bridget. I'm going to take a look at that one. The next one, Bridesmaids. I saw this a while ago. I'm not a fan, as you know, of rom-coms, but I actually thought this was not bad. Melissa McCarthy. I don't know whether it's one I'd watch again, but I did enjoy it. Next one, Please Sir, starring the wonderful John Alderton. Basically trying to teach a classroom full of kids who are at least in their 30s. We never thought anything of this back then. But if you look at this now, all of these kids are like in the sort of mid to late 20s, early 30s, and obviously playing school children. It's bizarre to look at it now, but at the time we never thought anything of it. But it's a cracking comedy. Greyfriars Bobby. Never seen it. This is a four-legged friend story, isn't it? I don't know much about it, but it's one that I do want to watch. This is one I've never even heard of. The Leap Year. I can't say anything about that because I've never heard of it. Mermaids. The film wasn't bad. But to be honest, I didn't enjoy it that much, mostly because Cher's cover of It's in His Kiss absolutely it irritated the hell out of me at the time. It was number one for quite a while. It was all over the radio. It just did me head in, so it kind of turned me off the film. I have seen it. Bob Hoskins was in it, if I remember correctly. The film itself is not bad, but it's not one to watch again, I don't think. Personal Services, what a classic. Julie Walters, directed by Terry Jones of the Pythons. Yeah, I learned all about Pobbozoglues in Personal Services. And if you want to know what a Pobbozoglue is, just watch the film. It's the story of, or the thinly veiled story of Cynthia Payne, who was a brothel madam who set up business in the middle of a suburban area. And she basically catered to the kinkier side of life, let's say. Absolutely marvelous film, bold as hell for its day. Well worth a watch if you've not seen it. East is East, another one that you can't really say much about. It's just brilliant. That's one you need to check out if you've not seen it. British comedy at its best. You've got a box set there of Norman Wisdom. What a handsome looking box set that is. I loved Norman Wisdom films. There were three. That I used to watch over and over again. On the Beat was one. Trouble in Store was another one. And The Early Bird, which was my favourite, which is the one where he played a milkman with a horse called Nelly. Oh, it's just superb. He played, let's see, he worked in a small dairy that was about to be swallowed up by a huge conglomerate. And they were basically trying to get him to sell this dairy to them, and they weren't going to do it. It's just a marvellous comedy. It used to be on regularly on Saturday afternoons, and I always used to watch it. So yeah, huge fan of Norman Wisdom. Whistle Down the Wind. Oh my God, Hayley Mills, what a classic. What have I got here? I've got any notes. Oh, she debuts alongside Alan Bates in one of his early roles. Basically, it's about, if you've not seen it, and everybody's seen this, about a group of kids who find an escaped convict in the barn. And for some reason, and I can't remember how, because it's been a while since I've seen it, they assume it's Jesus. And they're basically bringing in things and keeping him safe and stuff like that. Marvellous, marvellous film. Never get bored of it. Next one. To Wong Fu, thanks for everything, Julie Newmar. If you've ever wondered what Patrick Swayze and Wesley Snipes look like in drag, this is the movie to watch. They look incredible, I have to say. Obviously, the movie was following in the footsteps of Priscilla, Queen of the Desert, which I think was out the year before. Not sure it was as good as Priscilla. I really, really enjoyed Priscilla, but this one wasn't bad. Basically, for the novelty of seeing these two action movie stars dressed up as women, I thought it was amazing. Next one, The Witches. Now, this was an adaptation of a Roald Dahl film. This has got quite a reputation over the years as being one of the scariest kids' films ever. I haven't seen it. I know Angelica Houston was in it. So that's one I really need to catch up with at some time. The First Wives Club. What a cast. Goldie Hawn, Bette Midler and Diane Keaton. Basically, three women that are reunited by the death of a friend. They're all divorced and they decide to get revenge on the husbands that left them for younger women. The script is amazing. It's as bitchy as hell. Absolutely loved it. I haven't seen it for a while, but I do remember enjoying it. Another one of Bette Midler's is on your list here. Down and Out in Beverly Hills, where she stars alongside Richard Dreyfuss and Nick Nolte. I saw this at the cinema when it first came out and really, really enjoyed it. If I remember right, it was one of the first movies that Touchstone released. They did a series of comedies, raw American comedies, including Ruthless People, which is my absolute favourite. Absolutely love that movie. But Down and Out in Beverly Hills, definitely worth a mention. And the final one, I've never heard of, Tea with Mussolini. I know, tell a lie, I know Cher is in this, am I right? So you've got me curious about that one, so I've stuck it on my watch list and I'll be taking a look at that one as soon as I can. Right, let's buzz these up a bit. Have I got much more to go through? I'll tell you what I'll do. I will take a quick break and I will do a video which I'll call Extra Time, which will probably be about 10-15 minutes long. And it will I'll mop up all the remaining bits that I've got on this list here. So I'll be back probably with you in about an hour, something like that. So take care and I will see you very shortly. Ta-da. And we're back. I was going to do a separate video, but I thought, why clog up the internet with two videos when I can just sort of join the two up that I've already done. Oh fuck. And we're back. I was going to oh, for fuck's sake. Take three, and we're back. I was going to do two separate videos, but why do that when I can just join the two up and do them as one. Oh, fuck. Take four. I was determined to do this all in one take, but it's not going to happen, is it? I was going to do two videos, but I've decided to just join the last one and this one together. Basically to save time. To pick up where we left off, I'll start with the Q&A, seeing as I've got one lined up. Jason, thanks for replying so quickly to that. I can only assume the time difference over there helped a bit, because I think I posted that around about 5 o'clock this morning, and within a few minutes you came back with a cracking question. Worst movie you've ever seen? If we're talking worst as in bad films, I mean really bad films, there is only one that really springs to mind, for me anyway. Plan 9 from Outer Space. obviously directed by the legendary Ed Wood, who was brought to life in a movie by Johnny Depp, which I still need to have a look at, which basically I think explains how he came to be the man that directed this truly awful film that I do keep coming back to. I remember owning a copy of this, believe it or not, many, many years ago on Super 8mm, black and white, silent, because that's how we rolled in the 70s before VHS came along. All we had was Super 8mm, and obviously you had to have a projector, a screen, which my screen was a white blanket hanging over the door. And this was one of the first movies that I bought from a mail order company. I can't remember how much it cost. I believe it was my dad that bought it for me for Christmas. But I loved it, and I've had a soft spot for it ever since. It is truly terrible. The special effects are so clunky, you would not believe it. The acting is awful. But I think that's part of its charm. I don't know. It is a movie that I do need to revisit because I've not seen this for a long, long time. But if I'm classing this as the worst movie I've ever made, that I've ever seen, I would definitely say that I can't think of anything that was worse than this. I've heard of The Room, which is a much more recent movie, but I haven't seen it, so I can't comment on that one. So the answer to the question, what's the worst movie you've ever seen? Definitely, so far anyway, Plan 9 from Outer Space. Has anybody else seen a worse one than this? Drop your answers in the comments below because I would be really curious to find out whether there are worse movies than this out there. And if you've seen them, let me know what they are and I'll have a look because you know me, I'm a real connoisseur for crap movies. But yeah, let me know if there's any that you've seen that are worse than that one. So thanks for that one, Jason. Keep those questions coming in, please. I've got another one from Jason, but I forgot to write it on the notes, so I can't do it now. All the questions that you send me, they will be stored on my notes here. So I will not forget any, unlike when I forgot Bridget's top 10, which I do apologise for. But yeah, please keep the questions coming in. I need as many as possible to keep this going for as long as I can. Right, very quickly, I'll run through the box office top 10 for this week. Number 10 is Rye Lane. Now, this I really want to see. It's a kind of a rom-com set in Peckham in London, I believe. It's got absolutely blinding reviews. I know this will hold no weight with you, Guy, but Kermode loved it, absolutely adored it. And pretty much every review that I've read of Rye Lane has said it's amazing. So this is one that I do want to watch. Number 9, 80 for Brady. This is a sports-based movie, an American movie that reunites Jane Fonda and Lily Tomlin. Whether it would work as well over here with it being sport-based is another matter, but it's one that I wouldn't mind watching because I'm a big fan of both of those actresses ever since the days of 9 to 5, which I saw at the Odeon when it first came out. Loved it, watched it hundreds of times since, never get bored of it. So I am interested in taking a look at that. Number 8, Louis Tomlinson, All of Those Voices. I had to look this one up. I'd never heard of it. I got a vague inkling that it was something to do with One Direction, so I looked it up, and basically it's a documentary to do with mostly with his solo career, but how he arrived at that via One Direction. So it's not really my kind of thing, so that's one that I probably won't be watching. Number 7 is 65, Adam Driver versus Dinosaurs. The idea of this I love. A space pilot crashes on Earth and realizes that he's 65 million years in the past, and he's got to get from one end of the planet to the other whilst battling dinosaurs. So I love the idea of this. That's one I definitely will take a look at. Number 6, Puss in Boots: The Last Wish, animated, so it's highly unlikely I will watch it. It's got good reviews and it's got bad reviews, but it's not really my kind of thing, so it's highly unlikely I'll be watching that one. Number 5 is Alleluia. The cast in this is amazing. We've got, let's see, Jennifer Saunders, Judi Dench, Derek Jacobi, Russell Tovey. The only thing is, it's billed as a warm and deeply moving story about old age when the geriatric ward in a small Yorkshire hospital is threatened with closure. Now, you watch the trailer for this, and it looks like a comedy, and it looks like a bloody good one. But I've heard a lot of people saying that it's not much of a comedy. It's more of a drama and a pretty heartbreaking one as well. So much for truth in advertising. I wouldn't mind a look at it, but the movie I'm going to expect to see is the movie that I've seen in the trailer, not what I keep hearing it's going to be, but we'll see. Number four, Scream 6. Obviously, the latest franchise in the Scream series of movies. I've seen them all. What I would like to do, which I think I said the other week, is to watch the previous Scream movies before I see this one. I saw the one from last year, which I quite enjoyed. I can't help feeling that they're going to get some steadily more ridiculous as the years go on, but because I don't think we're done with them just yet. But I would love to see the first five again before embarking on this one. Number three, Creed 3. Yes, most definitely I'll be watching that. I've got the two Creed movies to get through, seeing as I've just finished the Rocky box set. I've got those both on Blu-ray. There's not a release date yet for Creed 3, but I will almost certainly be getting a copy of that one to watch. Number two, Shazam, Fury of the Gods. Superheroes, it's not really my thing. I'm enjoying the Marvel journey I'm on, even though it seems to have stalled a little bit. I'm only up to Thor, the original Thor, so I'm way behind. But what I've seen in the trailer of this, it looks all right, but it's not one I'm going to be making a beeline for. And number one, John Wick, Chapter 4. I knew this was going to do it. I knew it was going to topple whatever was on the top of the charts last week. It's 3 hours long, but it's taken, let me get this right, a staggering £5,321,533 in its opening weekend. Dave Oliver, our man from Savage Zombie Reviews, he absolutely adored it. I watched your video basically before I did this one, and you absolutely wax lyrical about it. You love it. I didn't doubt for a minute that you would. Whether it's my kind of thing, I don't know. I've never seen a John Wick film, so I can't comment. What I've seen of the trailers, I don't think I could cope with all of the bone crunching that goes off in it. I don't know. Maybe you lot could persuade me to take on the John Wick franchise. But 3 hours, wow, that's a hell of a running time. But apparently, there's not a minute of wasted screen time in it, so maybe I should take a look. And that is the box office top 10 as it is now. Right, I'll do this what am I watching section basically before I lose my connection on here. I'll play you a little bit of a soundtrack, and then what you want to do is drop in the comments what you think this movie is, and I will give the answer next week. So much for that. Here we go. I think you'll get this. This is the opening titles. Guy will almost certainly get this. I'd be very surprised if he didn't. I think Jason probably will as well. There you go. I don't think we need to go any further than that. And that is the main title from the movie. So drop your comments or your answers in the comments below, and I'll give you the answer to that one on next week's Sunday service. Now, bring your notes back up again. Let's see. Bin it or keep it for this month, week. Here we go. Rambo. Right. Where do I even start with this? This is the only one of the franchise that I hadn't actually seen. I did see the first three, obviously in the 80s when they came out. I thought the first one was excellent. The second one was just, well, it was horrible, basically. And Rambo 3 was just silly. But whether I'll have a different opinion of them now, I don't know. I managed to get Rambo 5 watched a few months back. Quite enjoyed it. Difficult watch. this takes the expression difficult watch to another level. I mean, if you've seen this, you'll know what it's about. Basically, John Rambo is living an idyllic lifestyle as such in Thailand. He captures snakes, which he sells to a place that puts on sort of shows for tourists involving snakes. He's approached by a group of missionaries who want him to take them on a boat to war-torn Burma to help out the locals, educate them, all this sort of thing. He reluctantly takes this on, and war-torn Burma is just horrible. I have never seen basically violence like this. This is possibly the worst one for violence in the whole franchise. The positive side of it, it is really, really well done. It's written and directed by Stallone, which he does a lot of, and he does a cracking job. It is beautifully filmed. The acting is superb. I did have trouble with the throat ripping, and the final 15 minutes just takes your breath away. You weren't kidding, Rick, were you, when you said the last quarter, your jaw will drop? It certainly did. I thought it was really, really good. It was just a hard watch. I think the hardest part of it for me, as I said in the comments on the YouTube video, was the newsreel footage, which made the whole thing very, very real. A lot of the violence was pretty much cartoon violence. Obviously, when people get shot in other films, you just see a few holes, a bit of blood, and they fall over. The guns in this literally shred people. There are heads exploding. There are limbs flying about all over the place. Heaven knows what the body count was in this one. It must have been absolutely fucking horrendous. But I thought it was really good. For what it was really, really good. As for Bin It or Keep It, will I watch it again? There's a possibility I will. Especially if I manage to get hold of a decent box set of 1 to 4, which I believe you can get for about £13. If you want 1 to 5, which includes this one, I think you're paying about 60-70 quid for it. I will probably end up getting the box set of 1 to 4 and holding on to this. So that is a keeper. But it was also a complete shocker. You weren't kidding. So if there's any other movies that you want me to take a look at in a similar vein, you know my views on extreme violence. I'm not very, I wouldn't say I don't like it, but I can't watch it. If you've watched that video, especially the first one, the Freddy Got Fingered one, that was a vile piece. That was horrible. But this one, pretty much the same reactions. I just don't do violence, not on that scale anyway. But I'm certainly glad I've seen it. I'm certainly glad I got through it in one piece, let's put it that way. So yeah, that's a keeper. Really, really enjoyed it. It was just a little bit too heavy on the violence for me, but there you go. Right, let's see. Finally, I've got, just make sure I've not missed anything here. Oh, there was something I was going to show you. That's it. This is something that I was going to show off on yesterday's Saturday review, but completely forgot about it. Oh, bloody hell. This is a book that I got hold of. Guy, you will not like this at all, but it is a beautiful thing. Now, this isn't even out of the cellophane yet. If you want to see what's inside it, I can do a little video, I suppose, of that. But this, Doctor Who and the Daleks, which is the official story of the films, not the series, the two movies that star Peter Cushing as the Doctor. I've seen pictures of this on Amazon and the illustrations. It just looks like a gorgeous, gorgeous book. So I'm really looking forward to having a look at this when I can be bothered to take the cellophane off. I only got it a few days ago, but I meant to show that off yesterday, but never actually got the chance. But yeah, I will do a proper little video of that, as I will do one of the Star Wars book. Yesterday, Guy, you were quite enthusiastic about that one. I will do a video when I get a minute, just showing you exactly what you get in it. I've got to come up with a way of doing it, because all this thing with holding them up like this and trying to show the pages, it's crap. It never works. It just looks terrible. So I'm going to have a thing where I can have the camera pointed down and I can just properly flick through it and show you what's in it. But I will do that for you guys as soon as I get a minute. Right, and I read an article this morning very quickly about Clint Eastwood. And I thought it might be a good question to set you guys. Which movie does Clint Eastwood regret making? There was a movie in his career that he bitterly regrets getting involved with. Apparently he got the script for this. It sounded amazing. The more the movie went on, they changed the script into something that he didn't like at all. He bitterly regrets getting involved with it. And my question to you is, can you guess which, or can you tell me which movie it is that he bitterly regrets getting involved with? Again, drop the answers in the comments below and I'll give you the answer to that one on next week's video. Right, I think that's it for this week. Thanks ever so much for joining me. Thanks for all the kind comments, especially on the Saturday review, which I will try and do a little more often. I think the last one was about 6, 7, 8 weeks ago. I'll try to do it monthly if I can. It just depends how many movies I've watched. There's no point in doing a Saturday review if I've not watched enough movies to do it, but I don't suppose it has to be half an hour. I could maybe just do a 15-minute one, but I'll do that. And if there's anything that you want to see me doing weekly on these videos, if there's a section that you want me to start that you think you might find interesting, just let me know. And obviously keep those questions for the Q&A coming in. Thanks ever so much for joining me for this extended little edition. If you've enjoyed the video, please give it a thumbs up and also like, subscribe and share. That'd be very much appreciated. Have a brilliant week, folks. Thanks again for joining me and I will see you all again at the same time next week. Take care. Ta-da.